He said, Pete, I wanted to let you know that I know your secret, that you didn't actually write those two books. And I said, what are you talking about? He says, the Imagine Life Differently, The Path of Life, you know, these two books, right, that I end up talking about all the time. It's got my name on the front of the cover. He says, you didn't write those books. I know you didn't write those books. I said, why? He says, there's not one mention of a whiteboard anywhere in either one of them. I read them both. Well, I use whiteboard here. I didn't use it there. Although he did challenge me to think of a way to incorporate whiteboards into the third book, as I'm working on that right now. It's going to be kind of hard to get a whiteboard into the first century, but, you know, that'll fester. Thanks. I appreciate that. That's going to fester. Okay, we learned that the word church is referring to a gathering or an assembly of people. That's what the word means, okay? Now, we have this word follower. And follower ends up getting defined in a lot of different ways. I've heard it, you know, preached and taught, kind of piling a lot of different things onto this word. But it's at its most basic level, follower simply means that they return again and again. They keep coming back. They go with him from place to place. So a follower is a returner. I know that's not a word, but you get the idea. I'm trying to help us keep it at the right level of specificity. Okay? Nothing about this word tells me what the person believes. It just tells me that they showed up again. A follower might be somebody like Peter, Andrew, James, and John, whom we know get, you know, designated as apostles later on. We're not going to get to the word apostle today, but we will get to it later on in the mix. Okay. It might be one of the folks that believed Jesus, but were not named on the 12. It also might mean it's somebody who is a Pharisee, a Sadducee, or a scribe who would write the scriptures out, and so therefore they were experts in the Old Testament, in the law, in the prophets. Okay? And when I say Pharisee, again, that's a word that carries a lot of baggage with it. We immediately think, evil, bad guy. Maybe even we give them a handlebar mustache, and they tie up women and put them on railroad tracks, even though they didn't exist back then. You know, that kind of thing. We kind of fit them for a black hat, right? When we say the word Pharisee. Pharisees were just the teachers of the day, the Bible scholar teachers of that day. Pharisees and Sadducees disagreed on a specific area of theology, and so you use the term Pharisee to talk about those Bible teachers who believed in the resurrection of the dead, and Sadducees were those Bible teachers who did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. They thought it was, we live this life, and when we die, we're die, and that's it, we're done. They interpreted the scriptures to say there was no second life afterwards. Pharisees, Sadducees, both Bible teachers, but they disagreed on that particular area of theology. Technically, Jesus, as a Bible teacher, then would have been in the category of Pharisee because he believed in and taught the resurrection of the dead. He also taught about judgment and heaven and hell and all kinds of good things. But he would have been in the category of Pharisee. So don't fit Pharisees for a black hat too quickly. Because Jesus would have fallen into that category, that description of Bible teachers. Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead. That's why they were so sad. You see? It's the best I got, guys. That's why I don't tell jokes, okay? Anyway, so follower can include all of them. And it can include Pharisees who end up working toward putting Jesus to death. And it can also include Pharisees like, say, Nicodemus, who had really deep theological, spiritual, biblical discussions with Jesus. And he let Jesus' teaching go into his theology. Another Pharisee that ended up on the side of Jesus and believing what he taught is a guy by the name of Joseph of Arimathea. See, so it's important that we recognize the word for what it means. Follower just means they kept back. They wanted to hear what the guy had to say. The equivalent today would be somebody who comes back for a second church service and a third church service, and they come to Bible study, and they come to the second Bible study, and they come to the third Bible study, and they come to serve, and they serve, you know, and they serve on this ministry team and that ministry team, and they keep coming back. That word, or that participation in or attendance at those events, which are church events where people are gathering together in Jesus' name, their participation doesn't tell me anything about their faith. It just tells me they keep coming back. Same way when we read it in Scripture, it's important for us to understand that followers just means that they were following Jesus around to hear what he, well, for various reasons. For various reasons. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Jesus has some fun with Nathanael. So how do you know me? Nathanael asks. Jesus said, "Well, I saw you while you were sitting under the fig tree before Philip called you." Now, this is before surveillance devices existed. Okay. And Philip did not see Jesus when Jesus saw him. The implication here is Jesus somehow saw him miraculously. You know, Jesus had a God surveillance equipment built in somehow and knew more about him than he should have known, especially considering they're just meeting now. We have several of these throughout Scripture. Another one that you might remember, there was a woman that Jesus encountered in Samaria called the woman at the well. We always refer to her as the woman at the well because we don't know her name. Okay? And she was a woman who just did not live a life walking with God. She meets Jesus at the well. She has a little conversation with Jesus at the well. And Jesus starts telling her about her whole sordid past. She had been married over and over and over again. She was living a guy with right at that time. And all of those things were against the law of their day. She is talking to him about religious stuff. She knows some good theology questions to ask him. And as she's doing this and asking him questions, he starts calling her out for her ungodly lifestyle. When she goes and invites other people to come see Jesus, she says to the people, "This man knew everything I ever did. Could he be the Christ?" And a whole bunch of folks showed up. You see, people come to Jesus for all kinds of reasons. The most common is being invited. And in this case, Nathanael responds to what Jesus has to say and says, "Rabbi, you're the Son of God. You're the King of Israel." Nathanael ends up following Jesus because Jesus knew things. Now, sometimes the things that Jesus knew were Bible. He knew his scriptures. Sometimes the things that he knew seemed to be insight into the scriptures that went even beyond the scriptures. But sometimes the things that Jesus knew, it was like, there's no way this guy should be able to know these things. And it was enough to put him over the edge. They came back. They came back again and again and again. They became a follower, following him around. Jesus said, "You believe because I told you that I saw you under a fig tree." Well, you're going to see greater things than that. And he did. But he did because he came back again and again and again. Do you give Jesus enough time to show you greater things? Do you show up once and then we're done? Or do you come back again and come back again and come back again so that Jesus can show you things that he knows, even about your life, that can be better? On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee, and Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples also had been invited to the wedding. You know the story, right? They run out of wine. Jesus' mother is there. She says, "They ran out of wine." He was like, "So?" I mean, it's the first century equivalent of "so," but, you know, "so? What do you want me to do about it?" She didn't even tell him. She just turns to the servants and says, "Do whatever he tells you to do." He ends up telling the servants, "Fill up these basins with water." They do that. He says, "Now go take a sample out and take it to the head waiter." They do that. And the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine, and he didn't realize where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. And he called the bridegroom aside, and he says, "You know, everybody brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you've saved the best till now." Sometimes people came back and came around him and became a follower because he performed miraculous signs. In fact, this is probably the number one reason that people came to church to gather around Jesus one time, was because they heard that he healed people. And because they heard about the healing, I mean, you know how word spreads. I mean, it travels fast. And you find out a guy could, you know, fix, you know, this arthritis that I've been battling for 10 years, okay? And all of a sudden, you know, I'm showing up. Wherever that guy is who can heal me, I'm going to show up. Jesus performing miraculous signs would bring people for the first time, and when they saw that he did miraculous signs, they would come back a second time. Some of them stuck because they were the ones that were healed. Demons were cast out, physical ailments. They couldn't walk and now they can. They couldn't see and now they can. They couldn't hear and now they can. All of a sudden, their gratitude for what Jesus had done brought them back again and again. Notice, it still doesn't say anything about their faith in who He is. It's just describing their gratitude for something He's done. We'll get into it more next week, but people can follow Jesus and not believe that He is who He is. People can come back again and again and again, and they're coming to church, see, they're gathering, they are following, they're showing up again and again and again, but they don't believe. They are not letting Him be Lord of their life. Well, He performs miraculous signs. It says that later on, Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee. He saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake because they were fishermen. At this point in the scriptures, as I shared last week, there's four different gospels that share the story of Jesus. At this point in all of the accounts, John, who is referred to as John the Baptist, is now in prison. In fact, we know a story about Jesus starting to get people who are coming around Him instead of John, before John is thrown in prison. And the third word that we're going to bring up for today gets used, and that is disciple. They talk about disciples of John and disciples of Jesus. And the word disciple simply means student. It's saying, I'm letting this guy teach me. Many of the followers were disciples. Some, as I talked about, were not disciples. They get used, the Bible uses words like detractors or against Him, whatever the case may be. They follow Him around, but they're not on board. They're not listening to His teaching because they want to follow His teaching or because they want to know. They're listening to His teaching to trap Him, to catch Him in a lie, to try to tear Him down, okay? And so the word disciple is describing somebody who's not doing that. They're learning from Him because they want to learn from Him. And in the beginning, John had a bunch of disciples, people who would come and he would tell them to repent for be baptized for the forgiveness of their sins, and they would go down into the waters of baptism. And then John tells us, the gospel writer John tells us, that Jesus comes and He gets baptized, and then He goes and he spends 40 days in the wilderness, and He battles Satan and He wins, and He comes back from all of that. And now Jesus starts to have people who are coming to Him. John even points people to Him and says, He's the one. He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. You should be looking to Him, listening to Him. And so some of John's disciples started doing that and listening to Him. And when people would gather around Jesus to teach, Jesus was hanging out around, you know, the same area, and there was water in that area, and Jesus' disciples would baptize people in Jesus' name instead of in John's name. What they were doing is still repenting and being baptized for the forgiveness of their sins, but they were also identifying themselves as Jesus' disciple. I listen to Him. I listen to John. See? And so here we go. These folks are doing that, and we have John telling us the accounts where John, the gospel writer, tells us about how some of John the Baptist's disciples are getting frustrated because Jesus is getting more and more disciples. More and more people are being baptized in Jesus' name instead of in John's name. And John the Baptist's response is, hey, I told you I'm not the guy. I'm the guy that points to the guy. You should be going and listening to him too. I must become less, and he must become greater. Not long after that, John the Baptist is arrested because of his preaching against Herod, and it always comes back to marriage and divorce and so forth. Herod ends up taking his brother's wife. And John preaches against him for that. And Herod says, well, I'm in charge. I got the soldiers, so in jail. At this point, when John is thrown in jail, scriptures tell us Jesus kicks off his real ministry. He moves forward. And so to help you to kind of immerse yourself into that with Peter and with Jesus, I would like to encourage you to imagine life differently. Imagine being in a boat with your brother Andrew. This routine has been a part of your work days ever since you were little children. See, you would take the net and gather it up and drape it over your shoulder. The long rope attached to it, and you grab the end of the rope with one hand and you throw the rest of the rope into the water ahead of time. You do the movement your father taught you. It's so important to get right. You grab the edge of the net, the part that has all the rocks attached to it, and you start the swinging motion. One, two, three. And as you do that, the net starts to fly out while you're holding the rope in your one hand, and the net opens up with all of the rocks as you make this motion and then finally release it. It's almost circular as it hits the water and the rocks start to pull the net down toward the bottom of the lake. You still have the drawstring in your hand, knowing that when you pull it, it will gather the rocks net portion together and create kind of a balloon that will capture the fish. You start pulling the rope and the net back up to see what swimmers it might have captured in its wake, and you can tell by the feel that there's nothing there. Again, it has not been a productive night. You're tired and you're ready to call it quits. So, looking over to another fishing boat, you see them heading toward the shore. Let's go in, you tell your little brother. We'll try again tomorrow night. It doesn't take long to navigate to the land after a whole night of fishless fishing. You're ready to clean up, pack up, and go home. Getting out of the boat, onto the shore, you wade back down into the water and begin cleaning the debris out of your net. And you sigh and you look up and hear noises from people walking toward the shore. It's the teacher, Andrew shouts. Which teacher? The one who gave me a nickname? Yes, yes, it's Jesus. At this point, you can feel your heart speed up as the adrenaline kicks in. I mean, you went to meet him the first time just because you were looking out for your little brother. But things have changed since then in a very short amount of time. The nickname was enough to make you chuckle, but it was Andrew's excitement that drew you back. And because of this, you had a chance to see him make water into wine. You're not sure what kind of trick he pulled that day, but whatever it was a good one. His teaching was different too. Some of the best teachers you know, the ones that you trust to lead you, were confounded by the way that he taught. You weren't surprised when you heard that more and more people were being baptized because of him, even before John was imprisoned by Herod. There's something different about this man. You wonder if that difference is led by God. Jesus had a crowd with him this time, which wasn't surprising with everything that he had been doing. Word gets around fast in this town. He went straight to your boat, he got in it, and he motioned to you to come over. He wanted you to push out from the shore so that he could speak to them and they could hear him. So you oblige him. Yes, you're tired, but you've started to enjoy his teaching. The time went by as he taught, as it always seemed to do. It went fast. You always seem to want him to say more when he's done. The other teachers never draw you in that way. And when he finished, he sent the crowd home, and then he turned to talk to you. Put out into the deep water. Let's let the nets down for a catch, he said. Oh, Master, we've worked hard all night and we haven't caught a thing, you hear yourself saying before you could stop the words. Yes, he's clearly a special man of God, but you're tired. You were ready to go home even before he got here. Jesus just looks at you with patience and kindness in his eyes. But because you say so, I will let down the nets. You finally give in. So you go out deeper into the water. You stop at the same spot that where you were fishing all night without success. You pull out the net, you drape it over your shoulder, and you think silently to yourself, one, two, three. And then you throw the net and watch the stones pull toward the bottom once again. But this time it was different. Before the rock sank all the way to the bottom, you could see the rope moving. You wait for a moment before pulling on it to draw the bottom of the net around its captees. And when you start to pull it up, you realize that you just hadn't caught a fish or two. The net was full. I mean, it was so full that you couldn't pull it up onto the boat. It was starting to tear. It was right at that moment that it hit you. Andrew was right. He's the one. His teaching, his healing, his miracles, he's got to be the one. And so you drop to your knees in fear. Get away from me, Lord. I'm full of sin. Andrew and the others come over to help out with the net. James and John come over from their boat to help out. Everybody is amazed at the size of the catch, and they work together to bring the fish into the boat. But you're not paying attention to any of the activity anymore. Your focus is just in the same boat with you. Your focus is on him. Don't be afraid, he says. From now on, you will fish for people. You have no idea what this means. But his words flow over your mind with a wave that finally brings peace. And so, they pulled their boats up on the shore. They left everything. And they followed him. It's an excerpt from the next book that I'm working on. And I will tell you what I will say each time. That when I use the "I would like you to imagine life differently," what I'm trying to do with those imaginary pieces is I'm trying to help you to immerse yourself into the truth of God's Word. There are pieces in the imagination part there that I'm putting there to help you to immerse yourself into the story. But if you want to know what the Scriptures actually say about that account, you can read those in Matthew 4, Mark 1, and Luke 5. I've got the passages there so that you can read them on your own at home. It brings us to the third reason that people followed Jesus, and it was because He offered to teach them. He offered to teach them. And they became His disciples. "Come follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." We have in Mark's account, and Mark, if you remember from last week, is the gospel that was attributed to Peter. It's Peter's gospel. Mark wrote it down. At once they left their nets and they followed Him. Will you follow Jesus? Will you go the step further and become His disciple, committing to learn from Him? If you do, we'll keep pointing you there. We'll keep sharing His teachings so that you can follow Jesus as His disciple. We have a time where we worship God in our time of offering. And we do it to support the work that Jesus is doing. Jesus told His disciples, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded. I'll be with you through that, even to the end of the age." We shorten that to a simple statement: empower one more to walk together with God. We'll find out later in coming up weeks how Jesus' ministry was supported, but it was supported by His followers, by His disciples. Those who were going around with Him made sure that He had food to eat as He ministered. That's what we do when we bring in offerings here. We support this ministry. It pays for the lights and the heat and the mortgage on the building. It provides resources for this ministry to empower one more to walk together with God. But more than that, we know that it's an act of worship. We know that it's an act of thanksgiving, thanking God for everything that God has given us. And we know that we're participating in ministry as we give. If God is calling you to give, now's the time to do it. But you don't ever have to feel pressured by me or somebody else. God will lead you if you should and how much you should. You can always participate in this part of the service by taking that Connect card that you filled out, the prayer requests that you wrote down, and put that in the bag. Turn that request over to God and just say, "God, I trust you. Boy, this stuff that's going on, it's bigger than me, but I know it's not bigger than you." Let's give our gifts at this time.
Everything I need, you've got. There's honey in the rock. Mm-hmm. can satisfy. Sweetness at the mercy seat, now I've tasted, and it's not hard to see that only you can satisfy. There's honey in the rock, 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 yeah. Where the spirit is, bounty in the wilderness, you will always satisfy. There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know everything I need you got. There's honey in the rock, purpose in your plan, power in the blood and healing in your hands. Started flowing when you said it is done. Oh, everything you did's enough. I keep looking, I keep finding, you keep giving, keep providing. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. And I keep praying, you keep moving, keep praising, you keep proving. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. I keep looking, I keep finding, you keep giving, you keep providing. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. I keep praying, you keep moving, I keep praying, proving I have all that I need. You are all that I need. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. Yeah. There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. There's honey in the rock, purpose in your plans, power in the blood, and healing in your hands. Started flowing when you said it is done. Jesus, who you are, is enough. There's honey in the rock. 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 Stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. Everything I need you got. There's honey in the rock, purpose in your plans, power in the blood, and healing in your hands. Started flowing when you said it is done. Jesus, who you are,
you know, Jesus invited everybody to follow him, but not everybody responded positively. Different people gave different excuses. I'll follow you eventually. I'll follow you after this is done or that's done. We know the story of the rich young ruler. Jesus invites him to follow. and he just walks away. It's important for us to remember that people rejected Jesus too. I mean, to the point that they were able to get a crowd against him, yelling, "Crucify, crucify." Jesus honestly, openly told his followers what it would mean to follow. His disciples, what it would mean to be his disciple. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me, he said. Being a follower of Jesus, he starts to teach them, means being a disciple who will listen to him. But even beyond that, it means letting him lead as Lord. Jesus would take up a cross and would go to his death, because that was his part of the Father's plan. When he died, God made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, so that through him we would be made the righteousness of God. Jesus' death gave us life. But he told people who wanted to follow him, it's not going to be about just hanging around with me. It's going to be listening to me and what I teach as my disciple. And it's not going to be just listening to what I teach, but doing what I tell you to do. Because while you don't need to go and die on a cross, you will have your own cross that you need to bear. You will have your own part of the Father's plan, and I will lead you in that so that you know what it is and you do it. Because whoever would save their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for me, Jesus said, and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world but forfeit their soul? And what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? Well, see, we can't. We can't buy forgiveness. We can't buy eternal life with God. We can only receive it as a gift from the one who paid the price. And that's Jesus. If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when it comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels, he said. Every week we have communion to remind ourselves of Jesus' death and its meaning. We also have it so that we will take the time to humble ourselves before him and let him lead us as our Lord. When we take the bread, we remember that his body was broken, and we understand the meaning of that because of the Last Supper. For those of you who are sitting at the tables and at the rows here, there are emblems, and I encourage you, if you believe that Jesus is the Christ, to take communion with us. We understand the meaning of his death and his body breaking because he took the bread at that last meal and he changed the meaning of it. The bread was originally for the Passover, to celebrate the angel of death passing over their Israelite households when they saw the blood of the Lamb. But Jesus took the bread and said, "This is my body, which will be given for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this and remember me." Let's take the bread and remember him. Later on in the meal, he took the cup. Once again, he changed the meaning of the wine in the Seder meal that day. He said, "This is the cup of my blood. It is the blood of the new covenant, which will last forever. It will be shed for you and for all people so that your sins will be forgiven. When you do this, remember me." The Apostle Paul wrote, "When you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord Jesus until he comes."
Come find your mercy, oh sir, come. you are.
Spring is almost upon us, giving us the cue to bust open the seed packets and start sowing.
This is the most satisfying part of gardening, sowing the seeds with love and care, then waiting with bated breath for the seedlings to push through. I've been doing this for years, and honestly, the joy of it all remains as intense as ever. So let's get sowing. Okay, so let's talk equipment. So you've got two options. Sow into pots, seed trays or flats, or this is an old mushroom tray like this. Then transplant or prick out the seedlings into plug trays once they've germinated, or just sow them direct into the plug trays themselves. Or if you've got really large seeds, like say zucchini or courgettes, you could sow one seed into a pot like that. So why would you bother sowing into a pot when they're just going to end up in a plug tray anyway? Well, you can get maybe up to a sort of 100 seedlings into a pot like this. So that's a great space saver initially, especially if you're going to, say, germinate them on an indoor warm windowsill. They'll take up a lot less space. Also, once they're up, it means you can transfer exactly one seedling into each plug, which you may want. So I start off in pots, plants like tomatoes this way, and also lettuces and anything in the brassica family, such as cabbages and sprouting broccoli, for example. And then I can transfer one seedling to each plug, nice and tidy. Sowing into plug trays is great for those vegetables that you want to multi-sow. That's just when you sow a pinch of seeds into each plug with the intention of planting the seedlings out as a cluster. There are lots of veggies you can sow this way, and more on that shortly. Or if you've got lots of seeds, then you could just sow a few seeds into each plug, then carefully hoik out the weaker seedling to leave just one in each plug. There are, of course, different sizes of plug trays available. Something quite small like this is perfect for most vegetables, especially if they're going to be planted out fairly promptly anyhow. It will also make for a much more efficient use of potting mix, because each one is going to take less mix. However, if you're growing bigger seeds, then you'll want something slightly bigger. So this would be good for, say, pole or runner beans, for example, maybe fava or broad beans too. While something really chunky like this is ideal for those squash seeds. All plug trays have excellent drainage thanks to these big holes in the bottom here. This gets air into the plug and encourages really healthy roots, which is just what we're after. This growing season, I've treated myself to these really rigid plastic trays. I've got lots of these here, but they split really easily and they only last one or two seasons. You could stack them two at a time, that'll make them more rigid, but better, I say, to invest in some really decent, solid plug trays. These aren't going to break, and they should last a couple of decades even. If you are going to use plastic, make sure you can just reuse it many times over at least. Gosh, it feels great to be sowing and growing again after the winter. I declare the new growing season open. If you want more on succeeding with seeds and seedlings, including how to grow more of your own food for free, check out this playlist. I'll catch you next time.
Have you ever seen anybody so excited about planting seeds? I'll tell you. I'm just being transparent and unashamed with you guys. I do not have a green thumb. Tracy and I have successfully grown things in the past, but we have, when we had kids, all the plants died. We're pretty sure we made the right choice. Kids live, plants died. What would happen to church if we were that excited about planting the seed of God's word into other people? You see, that's what Wednesday nights are about. It's about diving deeper into God's word, and this series, it's about encouraging each other to purposefully plant into others. Invite people to church. Build the scriptures into your time together with people so that
so that they and you are growing up in the Lord. You see, one plants, another waters. God causes the growth. God will bless our efforts if we choose to do that. So come on down on Wednesday evening to dive deep. And this week we're going to focus on the right equipment. We're going to find out if you got the right stuff for planting in others. You know, as they were walking along the road, a man said to Jesus, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus immediately told him, "That won't be easy. Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." Following Jesus isn't always easy, but I'll tell you, it's a lot easier than the alternative, which is not following him. Let's go from here being his church. Let's go from here and be his followers. Let's come back and be his disciples next week. What do you say?
I just love that video.
I do. It's the British accent that makes it art.
Oh, it's been good to be together, right? Yes. Come on, folks. Wow.